are studying the book of Revelation. Now, our point is that how we keep saying this, but you know I am trying to talk. It is not Revelations. It's Revelation. And it's not the revelation of God the Apostle. It's the revelation of Jesus Christ. It's the unfailing of God. It ultimately is. And it encompasses all of the scripture from Genesis chapter 1 all the way to the end of chapter 2, 22 in the book of Revelation. It's all encompassed. In fact, we learned that the book of Revelation is the culmination of all that. As we journey through this, we went through what we've been focusing on, as we said, when we started this. It's not going to be a typical study. We do not the book of Revelation. We're not just going to move through verse by verse, chapter to chapter. We offer. But what we're going to do is we're going to take a lot of different turns. Because we want to look at this from a different perspective, and I personally believe the perspective is whether or not it's caused the confusion that comes along with the book of Revelation. And it's based on that whole concept of being. I know that many of you already know this, but that John is a Jew. Jesus would have spoken to him as a Jew. He spoke to Hebrew. And so it's important to understand what John heard when Jesus spoke. Now, John welcomed from Greek, because he's going to go into the Greek world, which Greek was the universal language of the day. So God chose the Greek for the New Testament, not the Hebrew. So we're not saying that the Hebrew, the New Testament, should have been Hebrew. What we're saying is that instead, what John heard when he wrote it out, so we've been taking a little bit of a journey, a little bit of a detour, and we'll conclude this aspect this morning. But then immediately we're going to have to jump into another aspect, because if you're going to understand the book of Revelation, as I've already said, you've got to understand, you have to get hold of the fact that it is the culmination of all that has come before it, everything that God has done from the beginning, in the beginning, from that point on, everything that's recorded is brought to the conclusion in the book of Revelation. That's where he says that not only we need to understand, therefore, where it comes from with the Hebrew mindset, but we also need to understand what God was doing there and speaking to John and what John saw. Because we all have this vision of what we think of in this life. But what we don't know is that Revelation tells us exactly what it's like. And what it is like is what God established way back in the book of Exodus, which, by the way, we're studying the mimics of the ones in it. That within the Exodus, we're going to find that the tabernacle itself, the dwelling place, not that the tabernacle needs to dwell among them, to dwell with them, and the tabernacle would hold the temple to build, was what God designed for Moses to build this thing, because this was where he would meet his people. And there was a system for those people to live. So this thing called the tabernacle, we're going to need to understand this. Because everybody is looking here when John says, and I looked and I saw lampstands, and I saw the throne, and I saw the altar of incense, and I saw a seat. What he's seeing is the tabernacle. That's what he's seeing. Where is he seeing it on earth? No, he's seeing it in heaven. That's why in Exodus 32, I think it is, God told Moses, he said, look, I want you to build this thing. I want you to build it according to the plans that I've given. In other words, it was an earthly copy of a heavenly reality. That's what it was. So the book of Revelation is all around that. Don't read it into this weird stuff where John says, I saw the Lamb standing in the midst. That doesn't mean he's in the middle. He's encircled by it. It means he's in the midst. And it means within. Now that's strange for us, because he's in the middle. Now it tells us that a non-dimensional world is just three. But either way, it goes far beyond that, because obviously it's the spiritual realm that you're able to see these things. So for the whole book of Revelation, we're going to look at the tabernacle and begin to stop it. Because when you enter the tabernacle, you approach God, and the tabernacle is what you did. And by the way, the normal person can only go so far from that point on. Only the high priest can approach the actual presence of God, one individual. But there was a sequence of events of things that find to take place as you move forward to ultimately come into the presence of God as represented by the priest. Well, so if you're going to understand that, you've got to understand that system. Well, that system God taught them is called the sacrificial system. You know, give to God, which is where we ultimately want to be, without the sacrifice. Now, for them, this was an earthly member, earthly shadow of the heavenly life or reality. And so they use the animals, that there's a sacrifice of the Jesus of life is required to come into the presence of God. The old So we're going to need to understand not just the tabernacle, but the sacrificial system. And then God told Moses at the same time that they were to recognize the sending days that we call feasts. You guys, most of you know, because you're doing it on your clock. But that Hebrew word there is Moedim, and what it means is appointed times. God said, these are mine, not feasts, as we see in the English. These are mine appointed times. And they start off, there's three that are coming this spring with Passover, our first fruits, and then in the midst of all that, 3 months later, there's one that God said, my appointed time is called Pentecost. It's 50 days after first fruits. And then after days after that, then they go to what's called the fall feast. That is not the word for the Day of Atonement, the trumpets, Day of Atonement, and then Tabernacles. What's the point of all that? That's for the Jews. No, it's not. God said this. These are my appointed times. Not the Jews. Jews were just to observe them, to keep their minds on you. But what you're going to see, whether it's a tabernacle, the sacrificial system, or whether it's the appointed times, what you're going to see is every single aspect is speaking of the Lord Jesus Christ in the world. Every single one. We're going to take some time to look at the whole way of the Lord, because we don't have time to do that. But we definitely want to understand, because when John says, I'm going to be spared, which I'm going to be next. And he looks around and he sees all this stuff. What's he seeing? Everything that he just observed. Everything. So we're going to get more into that. So we're going to keep going, doing these kinds of things, because I want words to bring this all to life. So for the last couple of weeks, we've been looking at the first words recorded in the book of Revelation that was spoken by Jesus. And remember, God is quoting here in this verse something that Jesus has already said, but they're the first words recorded for us in the book of Revelation. And it is that incredible statement that we can take in time, which we see in the English, I am Jesus, said the Alpha, and I am the Omega. I'm the Alpha and Omega. I am the Alpha and the Omega. The first, the last, the beginning, and the end, him who is, who was, So these are the first words. So we've been taking time to look at that, because John was the word I knew how to talk, not how to make the important sound of the Christian Greek. But he's a Jew. Jesus was spoken Hebrew. So he said, I have to only talk. And we've been taking time to develop this whole concept of the Hebrew language. I pointed out several times that I personally believe that when God spoke to the prophet Zechariah in the third chapter, that when God said it in the last days before my indignation, was a small part of what's about to happen. We don't speak of that. So what we've been looking at is we look at the significance of that in the language within that context and begin to really understand what is happening. So God, the book speaks to John in Hebrew when he says, I will talk. And we talk about this concept of a pure language. For example, I will restore a pure language. It's a language that is deep. It's a language that has no comparison and that can't be changed. And if one language falls, it's not out there. Hebrew. All other languages have to be sensitive because it is concrete. Remember what we talked about. There's no abstract thinking within the language of the Hebrew. And just this is straight to the point that we talked about eternity. Eternity to us is the most difficult. But eternity to that last which God keeps holding to the prophets was the horizon. It's always the truth. It's nothing to find in eternity. It's all the sense of the world. It's the fact that no matter what it is, it's always the best. It's just the world. It's the world. That's the point. So the Hebrew language, I believe, and we see that's modern. But we're looking at those pictures that have to do with a huge role in that. So we took some time to look at what I believe is this cool language, both the modern, which we see often, and if we don't understand it, we can see that it looks like the bottom line of the park. We looked at some of the passages. But then we took it back to the front and looked back at the original microphone. It was only discovered in 1995. It was the oldest of all of these methods that we can use. And it is most difficult. It turns out the characteristics do not know, nobody knew how to bring this to school now. They didn't understand what it was until they figured out that that is ancient. It predates Sumerian, it predates the Phoenician, it predates Aramaic, it is Babylon. It is the oldest known religious architecture that's possible to come out of this much of time. So, then we looked at it, that's true, that the significance of this particular language. We need to understand also that unlike any other language, there are multiple meanings for just a single letter. A letter is more than just a letter. It has the word Baal, it's a word Baal, it's a word of faith, or Baal. So we learned that what this always means when you say the word. You know what the letter means? It's the first letter. It means strength, it means power, and therefore it means God. It's strength and power, it means God. But the word as always, you know, we broke it all down, we looked at how all of that, we even brought in some of that mathematical stuff to show you the truth of the value. This doesn't work in any other language. It just doesn't. We're going to build on that. We said, well, I think that's the same thing in this one. That's not our case. Understand the significance of what it is that we're talking about. That's what you're trying to drive home. Okay? We looked at it, when you take these letters, you break them down, and even though they look completely different, and sometimes because of who it has, a letter is a customer that's got different meanings within it, but it comes down to a meaning that everything is related in that particular language. Everything is down. Check it out. Check it out. It is truly, truly amazing. And what is amazing, if it has to remember, this language has ceased to exist. It had been gone since 70 AD when the Romans came in and destroyed the city of Jerusalem and the temple under Titus Decimus. It's in Saul the fact. He leveled the city, leveled the temple, and dispersed the Jews. It's called the Diaspora. It's been all over the world. That's how they ended up in Poland, Italy, and Spain, and Germany, Poland. Go on and on, Russia. Okay? That's how they ended up in all those places because of the Romans. So they went all over the place. The language ceased to exist. It was gone from history. Lo and behold, at the beginning of the 20th century, at the forefront of the 20th century, the last part of the 1800s, more into the 1900s, all of a sudden, the humanism. There was not such a thing as this. No such thing for the Jews. But there were thousands of Jews that were not Jews in this room because there wasn't this. It didn't exist. So suddenly, in just the last few decades, since 1948, all of a sudden, well, just a little before that, that's the Hebrew language. All of a sudden, there's Hebrew people. And these Hebrew people are what? Babylonian people. Exactly. Not exactly. Now, you lived from up to 1947, and the Bible is left. This may also be how there's no such thing as the Jews. There's no such thing as the nation of Israel. So the New Testament can't possibly be right. That's what they said. That's what we've been told. Single reason that is despised in history. Why? Because of all these things that we're talking about. By the way, if you want to ask a point of this, look at Ezekiel chapter 6, restoration of the land. Look at Ezekiel chapter 6, the restoration of the people as a nation. Two sticks being brought together by two men. The two people being put into the land of Israel. The two sticks being brought back together. The two men. So the land is restored, people of Israel restored in the land, and people are restored in 36 lands, so the people restored in chapter 37, chapter 38, and now it's the basis of the transition. The Ezekiel chapter is a different place in the Old Testament. can learn that fact by reading your Bible. May God be God for the God. You should be God. Worship. You may have all these different weird names and stuff like that. Come to my parents. Okay. Let's go. Ding, 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 ding. 20 years ago, I read the book. But all of a sudden, boy, they're really going to build up. And what they have to do is, what's the one thing that they have in common between them? It's the other thing. That's exactly what God said. Through not just the people, but the prophets. That's exactly what God said was happening. And the prophet is even, the folks, he's confused. He lived 5 years before Jesus came to his time. So we're talking 2,600 years ago. God said, "What's going to happen?" So we're watching. But our government and other governments of the world think we can go along with the future. If we could just get a little more people, that's all we need. By the way, God, the war in this world economy, is this the first time we've seen this happen? People who say this stuff is all of us sent in terms of the differences, everything before economic freedom, God, you know, whatever, religious stuff is all over. You understand that for the first time in world history, these problems are not over, they're not nasty, they're broken. It's the first time. The first time. And that, by the way, is a sign that Jesus told us. Almost sounds like he really means it. So it's just absolutely stunning when you start thinking about this. And that's why we're worried about what's going on in the world. Our God is sovereign. This is to take Indian by surprise. And he's sovereign enough that he gave us a warning. Look, if you disregard it, you take me out of your schools, you don't let your people pray to me, you take my commandments out of your justice system, you'll have no justice. Is there justice in our justice system? Are you serious? Oh, for some reasons, they hold you up tight. You're a problem. Oh, for the rest of us, we have to provide our God. Oh, God is God. Woe to those who call good evil and evil good. Woe to those who say that the truth is a lie, God is the truth. My goodness. So we're warned about it. This is what's going to happen to us. This should not take you and I as believers by surprise if we went to the world and folks, the open. It's not getting better. It's not. You're going to have to learn how to be unsafe. That's what we're going to have to do. Because our faith is not in our government or in government. It's not God who is far above heaven as our people. It's in our Lord and the Lord. So this is the significance of all of this stuff. I didn't want to all that. That was totally important. Let me tell you. Okay. So we've been looking at the Hebrew, but everything that was beast, this whole thing is enormous. So we moved our way through this, and we looked at how cool this language is. So it's unlike any other, and that God was going to use this and bring this up in the last days, and that's precisely what it's done. We touched on last week. This concept of the Aleph Tav, you know, the first and last letters of the prophet. Aleph, he said, strength, power, and forbearance, and the Tav, God, the Tav, the last letter. It's like a little to our people, to the best whole letter of the Hebrew, that it is the last letter of the Hebrew alphabet. It means truth, it means presence, it can be presence, but it also means a mark, or a sign, or a sin. Think of the way, so that's what all of these are. That's what John was saying. All of this. He was acting as if he was a believer. He was always so he would have understood. So what I wanted to do is take a brief journey. We're not going to spend a lot of time on this because we just truth and be here through it until the Lord comes back. So we just can't do that. We're just going to have to talk to this. I apologize if I'm straight, but what I'm trying to show you is this concept of all that time is so significant throughout the scripture. In the beginning, God created these people as the top. He's the first and last. Who's the creator? Jesus. The philosophy tells us. For John chapter 1, we can go on to what he created. So this all of the top thing becomes huge. We looked at last week how it begins to be associated with people throughout the scripture who have the problem. Proper relationship with God. And it's attached to their names. You can always see what it is like to do and what this is saying. So, what I wanted to do is look at another example. We looked at Cain last week. And how it's after the fall, and the Lord said there's going to be the seed of the woman. Through the woman, the serpent, the enemy, is going to be crushed. So, the woman is going to bring into the world the one. That would ultimately defeat Satan. So Eve understood that when she's now outside the garden, after they have disobeyed God, now she conceives that she has her first son, and his name is Cain. And it means I've acquired as much as God. But remember, Eve doesn't say, I've acquired a man from the Lord. That's the English, it is wrong. It is, I have acquired a man before. I have acquired a Yahweh. That's how it is. She thought Cain was the one son born to her through labor and all of the pain God brought into the world because of disobedience to God. She thought Cain was the one. That's what she thought. Seen upon his top until after he sees the hopes of the other top. He sees the other top, but he's not. So let's take a look at this and see just a couple of more examples of this. I want to set this in your mind because of where we're headed, because it's hugely important. So I want you to notice now Esau, and now this is before he sells his birthright. Remember, for those of you that may not know what's going on, Jacob had two sons, two were twins, Esau and Jacob. And they were constantly in pain. You know, at war with them, they didn't get along. But it's not, that's the twins. They didn't get along. One of them grew up from a big farm, and the other grew up a little more sensitive to hang around. You know, what we can call to make the mamas with Jacob. And so that's what ends up happening. Well, Esau, though, he's the only twins, was born first. He, therefore, by God's design, has the responsibility to pass the covenant from his father, Isaac, from his father, to his children. That's Esau's role. That's what birthright means. It can mean that he all of his riches, his cows, his golf clubs, and his Mercedes. Okay? That's how we see birthright. Oh, you're going to have to do all this stuff. Well, it doesn't tell us that. But what it meant was that he was the next one responsible to teach the covenant to all those that came after. He was responsible, in other words, to maintain the word of God in his family. That's what the birthright meant. Okay. But we know what happened. He went out and went up and came back. He was starving. And he said, oh, man, the birthright, what is this? Carry on the covenant with God. I'm going to go to the hotel. And I'm going to go to the hotel. So anyway, so he stands up, he says, I'm supposed to be fast, that's hard for us to understand what it's going to do, to understand how we think. And he's like, the rest of this is important, and I got to go to this book, but every full of fun, I'll get to this thing. And so, you know, I'm not going to be around, but I don't need a bit of time, so it's worth my time, so he's self-important. He gets it up, where did he get it over to? Of all the dentists, it's just, it's always going to be to our corner. Scripture's not going to. Scripture said, he sells for him. And even though I have to realize what he's done, he's well, he's in trouble with that. Because he disregarded his responsibility before God to no longer be able to responsible to do the work God has done. That's what he's going to do. And I'm looking for something. I say, God, he's not his dad's work hard. He's the something happens. Esau sells his birthright. Esau says, behold, I am the Lord of God. And what father shall his birthright be to him? That's what we're just going to check. Come on, we'll look at this thing. This is the same. Esau. What's missing? Joseph. He has moved himself out from being associated with the time that God has. We find ourselves distanced from God, we hold to God. This is Old Testament, and say God. But if we remove God, if we find ourselves at distance, it's because He has moved us. We're going to blame God for the situations in the world. He's not going to do anything that He does not work out in Scripture to give us the way out. If we find our way out, it's because we're going to be before God is again, this is right here. That is not what's happening. God is not the way to the churches of the Holy Spirit. He cannot be totally in the Psalms and the sake of the people by the sake of the people who in the Psalms and out of the state of the Holy Spirit. And by this, all people find sin. That is the fact that God is Lucifer, which we can afford to come up and talk about each other. So God does not turn away. He does not distance himself. If we go away, he stays where he is, and he calls out to us to return to him always, every single time. So don't blame God. This world, unless it turns back to God, continues to depart from his needs, and therefore depart from his needs and from his needs. And hopefully, stay.
and
he's sleeping, he takes a bite of his feet and puts himself in the sun. That sounds really strange, but that doesn't really mention it. Because when she did that myth, she had now placed herself under his protection, as well as his protection. You didn't miss it. You did not see this. So this is really hard. A lot of things I'm going to find, but what is that called? Turns out it's written. So he goes, okay, well, but there's another person that's worse. So he tells the person, here's what you need to do. You know what I'm going to do with this. That's why he's having to think. So he's going to go, well, I'm going to do this. And he's going to do this. And he's going to do this. And he's going to do this. So here's what happened. So Boaz says, I'm going to do this. And I'm going to take care of you. I'm going to redeem you. And you belong to the home. Because I'm your part of that. So he goes and meets some guy who's hiding up. And he says, listen, here's what he's got to do. And so, you know, if you're willing to do this, you've got to pay for the money. You've got to buy that little bit of salary. You've got to pay for that. You've got to pay for that. Three words. she's mentioned in the narrative that you just talked about, Paul's culture, it's incredible. When you go through all of this stuff and you see all of this and you're looking at it in the original, of course, this is the original, you see this fruit. That's what happens. Look after it. You already know this is sad. It's the same thing with these. Just a little verse. But overwhelmed with the more abundance, the widow is not allowed to ask the gods to use the cost of the gods. I have a father in this life. We can touch that the name of the Lord through this example. It's like the name of the dead has come down. And not the father from a mother's breath, but from his position of practice and the words of sin and the make decisions as a child. That's part of that thing. So you are witnesses this day. So, moreover, just the CC family, she's now a part of the covenant. This is really interesting because early on, when Naomi was going to go back and visit her husband, she had said, "You girls just stay in the earth, find yourself your husband," etc. The root makes us unrealistic. Your people will be my people. Do you know what? Some people were on the Facebook and Moabite saying concerning the truth. The Jews were not far from the Moabites. And so for her to make that statement, your people will be my people. She's knowing that there's got to be a complete change in who she is as an individual. She doesn't just say your people sit in the book. So this concept of origin is huge because it becomes this point of origin. What we're going to see as we go through the book of Revelation, you're going to see that God is going to tell the angels to go and to mark certain individuals with, we're going to see, is going to be the origin of. And you think Revelation, oh, it's the first one. Ezekiel was writing during the period of time, which is before the Roman system. Ezekiel lived in the days when Solomon set the position, but Babylonian was the same, but it's proven itself. But they disregarded their God of the Jews. They embraced the God of the Jews. They took the gods of Babylon, Assyria, Baal, and the left. They embraced all of those gods and God said, because you've done that and you've rejected them. This is discipline by God. And then the news about it that means you're going to be able to follow up on the news that you can use it. So the sin is rejected in God and God is so bad that God is going to bring you judgment. And that's something that is sure something that is going to be able to do it. Which will be the only one that will be able to do it. And Jesus came to us. So this is what's going on. All sorts of things that take place in this talk of God, how to know between these chambers, these guys, the priests, the little bit of the basement, and then these chambers. And it's within these chambers. And this goes on through this incredible stuff. And this gets to the people's book. ultimately what it is if they've taken all the stuff and then they can write the scenario of the world. So that if they're going to be able to do it, they're going to be able to do it. So what do we do is that we set a focal point. We want to be missing a lot of things before this. so they could make a deal of cross the sticks to the next time, and they would put it up again and pass it to the next time. Jesus said, a young man who puts his hand on the cross and turns it over again, there's a difference that he provides in the cross, which is grace, it's truth, and it's a sign of sin. This is actually sin. But that's what one sin is. It's the case that was at the right there. I was like, I don't know which one looks like Mark, because I think that's it. So, based on your Spirit is the guarantee of our inheritance until the redemption of the person that makes the exchange, moving from the foreign land into the home of the one that received it. So this concept of sealing, where did Paul get this from? So all in all, what God is doing from the very beginning is telling us exactly what he's doing. And there's the seal that you can see that's the Greek for these things. I'm going to say that it means the same thing. This is the Greek translation. This is the Greek word. And the Hebrew is translated into Greek. So what is that to me? These things can also be displayed in the Spirit, because it's just that it's a good peace that was consistent in those bodies. The fruit is part of their life, the thoughts are actually the same. That's what's going on. It's in the opposite of this peace. That's what you're going to do. These things, they don't have to be massive. They can be done as people say. And that's a little bit. There's something wrong with the picture. But I know I'm an RC. I'm clearly not. You know how many times I've been dealing with people like this? You know what I'm going to do? That's what I'm going to do. What was the word of Keith Green that said years ago? God, for the church does not make you a Christian any more than your doctors do. But we think it's church. What do you think? Together to see what God's word is and say, so these are the cherish Jesus. It's simple to this. What does all this mean? The reality was really cool that he's all time all the way up. Yeah, but here's the issue. What are you going to do about it? He promised to mark you, to guarantee where you're going. What are you going to do about it? You have a choice for this, and it is your choice. Nobody's holding the money up your head. The Lord is not going to follow you around and make sure that you do. He said, here it is. I don't even have to give my money for you. And if you trust and believe that the grace that God put in, I will seal you, and I will take you unto myself. That's my promise to you. And the guarantee is my Holy Spirit. Who would try to work on it? It's very simple. That's all that it is. It's a simple piece of faith, which is why Jesus said, if you don't become one of these kids now, you won't see what was he saying? That's what happened to his father. They're like these little kids. Oh, man, I thought we were all on the ground. I was sitting there doing that. First of all, you know, it's dirty. So my father had a heart for us. That's how we teach them. Right? We're walking around in the clouds. Hopefully there's support in the clouds. That's what we see. That's the vision that we call the Denver of the Jesus Christ. That's where he is. What was he like? Man, he walked with the apostles. He taught me. I mean, can you imagine what that would be like? We always think you're listening to Jesus' love and so we can should really count as a big church of Christ. You've worked as a Catholic. You see, no. You want to work on this church. And remember that for millions, and I meet millions of other believers to do what we're asking. Those of you that are used to this process of your life, we walk out here today, just walk. Religious about the gospel and the prophet and the prophet and the gospel and the intercession. No, religion. So if that's you, you can. And you need to come forward and make this thing. That's it. And it's not going to be the same. Thank you.